Amen. You may be seated. Our scripture this afternoon, force the habit. Our scripture this afternoon is going to be coming from Ephesians 3, verses 14 through 19. I want to invite you to open up your Bibles and follow along with me. Ephesians 3, verses 14 through 19. For this reason I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Let's pray. Father, I pray that you would reveal Christ to us in this passage, and that you would open our ears to hear your truth. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, as I was preparing for this afternoon for our worship service, I was hoping that maybe we could come to a prayer in Scripture that would encourage us and prepare us for the work that we had ahead of us. And as so often the Lord does, I picked this prayer out of Ephesians, and then this morning we had Andrew sharing all about what the Lord is doing in his church in Turkey. And now here we're going to look at this prayer to the churches in the very same area. And so my hope is just for us to see three things that Paul draws out and requests from the Lord that I think might apply to our own hearts and our own needs this afternoon. You'll notice at the very beginning, he says, for this reason I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. Paul wants to make it really clear at the very beginning here that he's not just talking about any God that might be in the region where they are, but he is talking about the very God of heaven and earth, the one who created all peoples, the great I am. This is the God that Paul bends his knees and prays before on behalf of his church in modern-day Turkey. Now you'll see there are going to be three things that he prays for, and I'll give those to you right off the top for those of you who like order. He prays for God's power for them, for Christ to dwell in their hearts, and for them to experience God's fullness. So let's start with verse 16. I pray that out of his glorious riches, he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being. That he would strengthen you with power. Just about this time last week, I was hanging out with a bunch of high school students up in the mountains, a couple hours away from here. And actually, around 4 a.m. tomorrow, last week, I was waking up so that we could all go and summit Mount Yale, one of the 14,000-foot peaks. I was with a group of junior and senior high school students and a couple of leaders and some guides from a place called Noah's Ark. And sometime around 10:30 or 11, after a six-hour strenuous hike through a lot of snow, we arrived at the top of the mountain, and after taking some pictures and patting each other on the back, first thing we did was huddle around together and sing the doxology. And so this morning when the doxology kind of broke out after Andrew Brunson was introduced, it just took me back to that other holy and sacred moment that I had just experienced. Now, on that trip, there was a lot of physical strength that was necessary to get us to the top of that mountain, and probably more for me than the students I was with. But when we see what Paul is praying for here, we see that it's not physical strength he's praying for. It's for strength in their inner being. And as I reflected on this, I thought back to this trip I was just on. We spent all this time doing these kind of physical, great activities in the outdoors, but we also spent time around the campfire every night sharing life stories. And what I found was what these students that I was with, not to mention myself as well, desperately needed wasn't physical strength to make it through each day. They needed the strength of someone that could step into the brokenness and aloneness that they are experiencing in their lives. You see, our students had all kinds of incredible joy to share, but they also had incredible sadness. Many had been touched by a friend's suicide, by lack of friends, by lack of purpose. You see, Paul right here is praying that his church would be strengthened in their inner being, that they would have power at their core. Not just that they would be strong so they could climb mountains, but that they would be strong so that they could face the adversities that are to come. So the first thing Paul is praying for is for power that comes from the Holy Spirit, that it would impact his church and their inner beings. So my question for you this afternoon is, are any of you struggling with loneliness, uncertainty, doubt, fatigue? Well, this prayer is for you. Second thing he talks about is Christ dwelling in their hearts. Look at verse 17. So that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. So he's asked for power in their inner beings, and now he's asking that Christ may dwell in their hearts through faith. So I want to make a couple of points right here. The first is, he's not saying that Christ doesn't already dwell in them, that when they received him, that Christ came into their lives. The word he uses here is actually that Christ would dwell deeply within you. So this isn't some new outpouring. It's this recognition that he desires for Christ to dwell deeply in their lives, that Christ would be the master of their house, that he would have complete and full control of them. So, do you desire that Christ might dwell deeply in your heart? Do you desire to chase after him? To run after him with everything that you have? How many of you resonated with Andrew's story this morning of that desire for more intimacy, to want more of the Lord? This is what Paul's praying for on behalf of his people, that Christ would dwell deeply inside of them. And then the last thing he prays is for God's fullness. This is the last section starting in the second half of verse 17. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. We notice that he prays that they would have power together with all the Lord's holy people. This is a communal prayer. This is something for the church as a whole to embrace. That you would have power together to understand. Now look at this. How wide and long and high and deep. Now if you've ever taken any hermeneutics or anything, you see what Paul's doing here, right? He's saying everything. This love is so great, it surpasses everything. It's as high as you can see, as deep as you can see, as long as you can see, as wide as you can see. There's nothing greater than this love. And he prays that they would know this love that surpasses knowledge. That you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now, do you see what it means to be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God? We hear that sometimes. We go, yeah, that sounds awesome. I want that. But what Paul is saying is to be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God is to understand the love of Christ for you. That is what it means to be filled to the fullness of God. It's to understand this vast, unmeasured, deep, deep love of Jesus. And that is what Paul is praying for his church. So my question is, if you're really honest, might you say that your love has grown cold or maybe calloused? If you're like me, are there some people that are easy to love and some that you've stopped trying to love? Do you long to comprehend the love of Christ for you and for those you serve? Do you desire to be filled with this love? You see, this prayer right here, this prayer is not rooted in just wishful thinking. This prayer is not dependent on the prayers, Paul in this case, perfection, our own good works. You see, it's not a prayer that is trying to persuade God to give him something that he doesn't want to give. It's not a formula to get what we want. No, this prayer is fully dependent on God's eternal purposes being fulfilled and the finished work of Christ on your behalf. Look at verses 11 and 12, right before this prayer. He says this, according to his eternal purpose that he accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord, in him and through faith in him, we may approach God with freedom and confidence. You see, this prayer is based upon the work that Christ has already accomplished. And so Paul can get on his knees before these people he desperately loves and cares for, and he can pray this prayer with confidence, knowing that it'll be fulfilled because it's already been fulfilled in Christ. So this morning, this afternoon, there I go again. I don't know where you're at, but I imagine that you could use some encouragement and a reminder of God's incredible love for you and his purposes for you. And so I would love for us to start our time before we move into the business of the assembly. I'd love to just pray this prayer together. And so I'll just lead us. I'm going to change the words a little bit just to make it communal for us, but I just ask that you would just allow this to be your own prayer for today. So let's pray. Lord, for this reason, we kneel before you, Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. And we pray that out of your glorious riches, you may strengthen us with your power through your Spirit in your inner being, in our inner beings, so that Christ may dwell in our hearts through faith. And we pray that being rooted and established in love, we may have power together with all the Lord's saints to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, that we may know this love that surpasses knowledge, and that we may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. And we pray this with confidence in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. I want to invite you to stand up for our benediction. And I'd love it if you would just grab the hand of the person next to you as a physical reminder that this is something that we are in together. And for our benediction, I'll use the same benediction that Paul used after this prayer. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever. Amen. Amen. Amen.